Murder. There's been a murder on the island of Penang. And if you've ever crossed from Butterworth over to Georgetown with a ferry, on that ferry coming into Penang Island, then you, where you arrive at the ferry, you can walk to the crime scene. It's not very far. It happened on a Monday, the 8th of February, the day right after Chinese New Year. Happened in the morning, a Monday morning. And on that day, the heat, it came up from the asphalt, where they've asphalted new roads all throughout Georgetown. It's incredibly hot, and the heat traps during the day, and it was just a warm blanket on that morning, suffocating everyone in town almost. But one time, there was a time in Georgetown where you could feel the cool ocean breeze. It came blowing in off the water, cooling everything down. But no more. Once you could smell the trees, you could smell the flowers, you could smell the moisture in the grass, you could smell life. Back when beautiful old mansions lined the North Beach, these beautiful old mansions made of teak wood and beautiful tiles, old buildings built 100, 150 years ago, these beautiful old mansions. Now the only thing you can smell in Georgetown is the bouquet of car exhaust. But back to the day of the murder, the Monday morning, the day of the murder in Penang, a man whose name really isn't that important because it could have been also a woman, it could have been someone young or old, it doesn't really matter, the man whose name really isn't that important, because he was doing his job. That's all he was doing. It could have been any one of us, anyone with five fingers on the left hand, five fingers on the right hand. This person whose name isn't important, he gets lonely sometimes. He's usually hungry around 12 noon. Sometimes he feels like nobody listens to him. A person like you and me. He's a good man. He has a family and he carries on the values that he was taught from his parents. He grew up in Georgetown. And he wakes up on this Monday morning and he walks out of his apartment. And he lives in a high rise and is right on the water. And you think, wow, that must be really nice, a big condo looking over the sea. But he can't see these historical waters, the Straits of Malacca from Georgetown. He can't see any of that. He doesn't see these beautiful, vast waters where men and women of all different ages came from all over the world, really, from India and China and what we now call Indonesia, the Straits of Peninsula of Malaysian Peninsula. All over the world, people came to build a better life on this island, the island of Penang, which was earlier just a bunch of fishermen, fishing communities. He can't see that. All he can see is a row of uniform windows, blockish satellite dishes and bras, underwear, t-shirts, all hanging out to dry. That's what he sees when he wakes up in the morning and he gets out of bed and he walks down the stairs, these dirty stairs, smell like urine. And he takes the stairs because the elevator is broken, again. And as the sun comes up, he gets on his old rusty motorcycle and he drives through the heart of Georgetown. And he arrives at these big metal gates, you can't see anything through them, they're solid. And a security guard opens up these gates and he drives through these big metal gates that wrap all around the whole block, usually something, you know, to keep people out, but also to hide something, hide where crimes are committed so people can't see what's going on the inside. He drives in, and he was surprised as he went through the streets of Georgetown how quiet it was that morning. It was unusually quiet, of course, because the night before was the eve of Chinese New Year, and everybody in Georgetown was celebrating. They're celebrating in their own way. It doesn't matter if they're Hindu or Muslim or Buddhist or whatever. Anytime there's a celebration in Georgetown, everybody's going to take a little bit of time, maybe an hour, a few minutes, maybe the whole evening and eat, you know, asam laksa or epom or mi udang or nasi kandar. Everyone was stuffed And that means that morning when he went to this job, everyone was full, they were stuffed, they were sleeping. It was in a very meticulous crime plan to take place exactly on that morning. It was a bloodless crime. And he went in to this compound, and there was a big glass cabin on top of what, like tank wheels, and this big arm of steel coming out of the cabin. And he went up to the cabin and he put the key in the ignition, and his left finger was hovering over the start button. And he was just about to start this big steel death machine, and he had a flash. You know how sometimes you smell something, maybe it's perfume, you smell a perfume, or you taste something, and then you have this beautiful flash, this memory, and it takes you back to somewhere really special. And it's so physical, this memory. And that's what he had while he was sitting in this backhoe. He looked at this old building in front of him, the building he was being paid to destroy. And he had this, looking at this building, he had a flash, and it took him back to, his right hand was holding, his father was gripping his right hand, and his left hand was being embraced by his mother, and they were walking along the beach somewhere in Penang, maybe past this old building on the beach, this old building he was being paid to destroy, and he remembered his mother and father, and it'd been so long since he'd seen them. He almost forgot what they looked like. He could smell his mother's wash, how the wash smelled when she washed the clothes, and he could almost feel his father's rough hands when he came back in from work. And he heard the sound of laughter, and it was such a beautiful, beautiful memory. He forgot for a moment that he was not a rich man. He forgot for a moment that he had old worn-out shoes and that the rent was due again. And he felt so rich in Georgetown, this town with such, where he grew up, all this cultural history where people came from all over the earth to work there and eat, and the sound of the prayers from the minaret from the Malay Mosque, or the sound from the smell of walking through these clouds of spices in Georgetown and Little India of curry and cinnamon. And he forgot for a moment how poor he was. But then as suddenly as that memory came, it flew back away like a bird. And he looked out of the glass at this old building he was being paid to destroy on the early morning, kind of almost like a covert action. And he saw reflected in the glass, superimposed on this old building, almost like a vision. He saw images, people's faces, stories. And this is what he saw.
H-A-W call. H-W-A, hua. Mungkin semua PM jaro pin, ya. Ah, ada ni kau ni. Ya, kita tunggu cuci di tanah ni.干物件，只那几项物件做的。 That's enough. Yep.
My name is Vivian. My business is a Chinese medicine herbs. This is all family business. And together with my sister, my younger sister, my turn take over until now. Do the Chinese herbs more than thousand and thousand type of name. So maybe one type of the herbs, they got two or three names too. This basket, I think, is older than me. We put the medicine into the basket because it's for us easier to find it. Yeah. We mix together the medicine. After that, we make it as a powder using like this. Maybe we come small, small, small. My two daughters is 6 years old and 8 years old. So until now, they never drink the soft drink. The gas drink, they don't have. So also no candy, sweet, they also know. Never took before. So until now, every time I just put like pieces ginseng, put into the bottle. Same as my mother. I also every day I give 2 pills for ginseng every morning. She can take care of my 2 daughters, can wash, can clean up whole homes, and can cook. She is very, very healthy woman. Yeah. Somebody, they don't have enough money, is very poor people, or maybe it happened on the family problem. So they will ask for the medicine. We all is FOC, free of charge. It's all free of them. This is my dad business way. Actually, we very miss our father. Xu Ling Rui Nan Xian Sheng.
I have to apologize. I wanted to do at this juncture a little piece called Lim Guang Eng Drives a Car. And it was going to be really funny. It's going to tell the story about Lim Guang Eng and the Mercedes-Benz S-Class L. And you know, I wrote the story, and then I started changing around the parts to kind of, you know, make it funny. And because I thought it was a funny story originally. And then I wrote it, and I changed the parts around and tried to add some funny elements. But the more I worked on it, it just turns out, I'm really sorry, it's just not a funny story. So, you know, I just couldn't get it to be funny. So what I thought I'd do today is just give you the facts. The facts of Lim Guang Eng and the Mercedes-Benz S-Class L. Because I know there's many people here tonight that are much more talented than I am. And I'll give you the facts, and you can write a story. You can maybe write a funny story, or maybe it's a drama about Lim Guang Eng and the Mercedes-Benz S-Class L, or maybe it's a tragedy, a Shakespearean tragedy. But I thought I'd just give you the facts of what happened. And if you don't know, Lim Guang Eng, he is the chief minister of the state of Penang. So that means he's the number one person in charge of Penang, the island, and the final decision maker here in Penang, and of also Georgetown, which is relevant because there's been a murder on the island of Penang here in Georgetown. There's been a murder. And as the number one decision maker, it's relevant. Lim Guang Eng is relevant. And at the end of 2013, in December, I believe, the state of Penang purchased a new car for Lim Guang Eng to ride in. A car for Lim Guang Eng to ride in because he doesn't have to drive. He has a driver. He sits in the back seat while his chauffeur drives him around. That's right. He has a chauffeur, the French, a driver that drives him around town. And it was the state of Penang, the money that was collected for the state of Penang from parking fees and fines and registration fees that all go into the state coffers, the state of Penang. The state of Penang spent the money from the people of Penang to buy a Mercedes-Benz S-Class L for the man who heads up the state of Penang, Lim Guang Eng, chief minister. And the people in Penang, when I did the story in Penang, they all wanted to know, so what kind of car did the money buy? You know, what all these fees and registration fees and monies go towards what kind of car did their tax dollars go to buy. And I can say it's a very nice car. It's a very, very nice car. It's a German car. It's a Mercedes-Benz S-Class L. And superstars like Jay-Z and Kanye West, they all ride in the backseat of this car. It's a very fine car. They're also chauffeured around, just like Chief Minister Lim Guan Eng, Chief Minister of Penang, number one decision maker. And the Mercedes-Benz S-Class L, the S in the Mercedes-Benz S-Class L stands for Zonda. It's a word that means set apart, different. S-O-N-D-E-R, Zonda. It's a car that's different than the other cars. It's different than, let's say, the Malaysian Proton manufactured here in Malaysia. Proton, that's a normal car. It's an average, everyday car. The Mercedes-Benz S-Class L is an extraordinary, a different, a set apart car. And the L in the Mercedes-Benz S-Class L stands for Luxus in Germany, which translates as luxury. So he's traveling in the backseat of a Mercedes-Benz, separate, different, luxury. It's an extraordinarily set apart, different car. A car much, much different than you will ever ride in, let alone own, or, well, maybe someday you'll have a chance to drive this car if you're a chauffeur. And many people want to know, well, what does this car cost? And this car originally cost 657,218 ringgit. And that's a hard number to visualize, especially if you're not from Malaysia and don't use the ringgit very much. So I thought of a way to visualize this this number. And so if you take a plate of cha kway chow, Mrs. Tan in China Street in Georgetown, she cooks cha kway chow, and it just costs 5 ringgit, just 5 ringgit. And so if you eat every day cha kway chow from Mrs. Tan, every morning, every week, every month, every year, you can eat for the price of a Mercedes-Benz S-Class L cha kway chow every day for the rest of your life. In fact, you can eat cha kway chow every day for the next 360 years, which is a lot of cha kway chow. But don't worry, because the state of Penang got a special discount, la, special discount, 100,000 ringgit discount from somewhere. I imagine maybe the Mercedes-Benz guys gave them a break, 100,000 ringgit. And the state of Penang didn't have to pay taxes and duties like normal people that if you buy a Malaysian Proton, you have to pay taxes, of course. So the final price, the final bill to the state of Penang was 271,331.22 ringgit, which is only cha kway chow for the next 148 years, which is much more attractive than 360. Lim Guan Eng, he could have said no. He did have a choice as the ultimate decision maker in Penang, the ultimate decision maker in Georgetown. He could have said no, and in fact, he was riding around in a Toyota Camry before this, a car that was only 2 months old. It's already a brand new car. So he had a choice, but the number one decision maker for Georgetown chose to ride in a Mercedes-Benz S-Class L. So I ask you, do you see anything funny in this story?
My name is Lien Chin Lan. I do recycle. Newspaper, the plastic. So the people come, I go and weigh. So after weigh, I pay the money. They all come anytime.
The unload is there's a plastic.
My workers and I all join together to work. I didn't separate out. No, I got time, I help them to do faster. We must do the thing very fast. Do very fast, the lorry can take away faster.
They are buying. They buy the newspaper. Newspaper and carton box.
Before that, people sell the newspaper to you. They all think that very shame. Nowadays, they sell the paper to you, they ask the money first. At night, you go back to your house, you sleep that moment, and the backbone really pain now. My name is Tan Ayo. My life is very happy. I just got so many children.
You can call me the Kim.
My name is Lim Dai Lai.
My brother?
My name is Tan Lai Im. My wife's name is Lee So Hyung.
My husband.
My daughter-in-law?
My name is Abi.
Lim Sing Yi. She's my granddaughter.
Hi. I'm doing here is business for my family business. Coffee shop, coffee, I make a char kway teow. Now it's 41 years I make the business. Yeah, same place. Yeah, so many people say I'm a very strong woman. But now I can't be so strong already, out my back bones pain. So I can't be strong. I must wait up to 4 months or 3 months, then I can be a strong woman again.
Just now I take care, it's not very pain. If I stand longer, I will get pain. Because I walk so many too long. Pain feel like cutting my nerve, you know, inside the right leg bones here, pain up to the back bones there. I will do a slightly operation.
Tomorrow operation. Are you worried?
No. Not serious operation, just a bit, laser. Just laser, not serious, a bit serious on this operation. About 10 o'clock, I must admit.
You're not worried at all?
Just a bit.
My mom is 18 years old, do working until now 60 years old. So it's 42 years old, she's working at here. And yeah, sure, I worry that sometimes it's very painful for her because my mom, he no pain, he won't go to hospital.
So how are you feeling?
I'm feeling very good.
Very good?
Yeah, it's really very good. I never feel dizzy, so I can walk to the toilet, no use to always ring the bell, ring the bell and call the nurse. Always ring the bell. I don't like it. I don't like to ring the bell. I want to do it myself. I ask people to help, it's very painful for me. So I will make it myself.
You didn't tell your sister before?
No. So I never tell them also. So my sister, every time gamble one, the sister told them, I'm really amazed. So why you never say? I said, I don't like to say. So you must say it, you're a sister. Because myself, I would like people to disturb people. So I wouldn't like people to ask for help. All they love me. So especially my sons, they are my daughter-in-law, especially they are very lovely.
You just came back from the hospital.
Yeah.
You just got back.
Just get back, I must pick up all the things. I can't just sit down and rest. Whole day rest, up to the hospital also rest.
Is the doctor worried that you work too much here?
No. About 2 or 3 months like this, I cannot do chakwe kyo. Because of the flying like this, cause the nerve downstairs down here, the hands here. Oh, you say I don't know how to relax. No, I don't like count of people. If I can do, I will do. It's all this. I don't like to depend on people. You want to have a coffee and make for you? After the surgery, it's still more pain. I still can stand it. But I go to the God and ask, what does the God say? This is fate. This is our fate, you can't take away. The doctor instruction is you must sleep more, then rest more, it will be okay more. But I never follow. Because of all my jobs, I can't follow the doctor's instruction.
Do you think you hurt your body because you didn't follow the doctor's instructions?
Oh, yes, I think so. When we are small, we are in a poor family. So small, about 13 years old, 14 years old, we're going out to work already. Going out to work for other people. We don't know how to depend on people. Everything work we must do. Oh, you do this, you do that. All the work you must do, all finish. 17 years old, I'm working in factory. Half a year like this, I already married. 18 years old, already married. I'm 21 years old. I already start working. Start all this work. And I own? Oh, quickly, I will pass away, it's okay. Then I say I'm strong woman because I one person, I take care of the shop. I would work all the things. So they call me a strong woman. You think I'm a strong woman?
McDonald's is the world's leading global food service retailer. That's what they call it on their website. It's a food service retailer. Normally, I like to go to restaurants, but they have food service retail locations in 36,000 locations around the world in 100 countries. The first McDonald's in Malaysia opened in 1982. And actually, the first one in Penang, just down the street, was opened in the big Komtar Tower, the big modern tower they built. And the first McDonald's opened up there when the Komtar opened up. And when the Komtar was not cool and hip anymore, they closed again, I think, in 2006. They moved somewhere else where it was newer and hipper. Right now, there are approximately 250 McDonald's in Malaysia, and they want to double that number to 500 by the year 2020. Very short amount of time. The managing director of McDonald's in Malaysia is a woman named Sarah Casanova, and I found a quote from her on the website, and she says, these are her words with my dramatic interpretation, "There are so many cities, big and small towns, where there is no McDonald's presence. And we continue to grow the business because Malaysians love McDonald's."
One, two, three. Hi guys, this is Ken from kenhansford.com. So in this video, we're going to feature five different types of dishes available here in Penang, which could represent the cultural mix environment here. Just follow me and I'll show you around. So we are at Macalister Road. We are going to eat a very nice Hokkien Mee, more like a breakfast food or sometimes brunch. Hokkien refers to the name of the cultural groups under Chinese, while Mee refers to noodles. A typical bowl of Hokkien Mee consists of yellow noodles, vermicelli noodles, and likely blanch, and they assemble the noodle with hard-boiled eggs, pork ribs, shrimps, and completed with a spoonful of chili paste. Next up is Ravi Devi and his wife, who have been cooking Indian appam since 1974.
From 7:30, we started our fire here.
I prepared the fire.
Oh. From 7:30 until around 11 to 12 o'clock, we non-stop keep on going. And this is what we're doing, the egg, sugar, all mixed together. Okay. So this is the made pan from India, from Bombay.
Oh, okay.
Especially for appam, non-stick pan. You must make it crispy.
All right.
When you eat, you can feel the crunchiness.
And fluffy in the middle.
And fluffy in the middle.
Having tasted authentic Indian food in Georgetown, we are now heading to Balik Pulau for some Asam Laksa.
Asam Laksa.
This particular stall is so special that they make their own noodles, and they are usually springier and bouncier as compared to other places. Asam Laksa is believed that it's originated from Peranakan cuisine. So Peranakan refers to the intermarriage between the Malay descendants and the Chinese. So we have one bowl of Asam Laksa over here. It's homemade rice noodles. So it has a chewier texture as compared to other places. I couldn't find a table. That's why I'm standing. A short ferry ride across to the mainland is a hidden gem filled with the flavor of Malaysia. We are here at Sungai Dua, Butterworth. We are about to try the famous Mee Udang over here at Our Gading.
So,
Mee Udang. So Mee Udang is a type of prawn noodles served with a very thick and rich seafood broth. You can actually add all these fresh prawns, crabs, shrimps and all that into your Mee Udang. It's famous for its thick and rich broth,
which the recipe has been passed down since 40 years, 50 years back. You can also add in your homemade pickled chilies, but they're really, really hot, so be careful with that. Wow, that's really hot. So today's last stop is Hamidiya, famous for serving nasi kandar for more than 100 years. The usual plate of nasi kandar will consist of boiled egg, fried chicken, and veggies, and drenched with plenty of curries over there.
We don't buy commercial spices and cook our curry. We do our own.
Oh, okay. Pounding,
yeah,
and all that.
Yeah, pounding everything. That's, you know.
It's the cultural mix that makes life here in Penang so spicy. But as for me, I'm stuffed. I'm hitting home for a nap.
I love art. I can release some pressure. And your satisfaction is there when you carve out the thing, then you feel very satisfied. I take it as an interest only. My family don't depend on me earn this money. I have my own massage center. In the center, I only collect money. I thought I'm wasting time there. So that type of job, I can employ anybody to collect the money. So this carving, I'm out of my interest, I carve. Mr. Ko, now he cannot carve anymore because too old. This is his order. He tell me to carve, help him to carve. Actually, I supposed to carve that one already. I don't care about the money. I want they appreciate my work. When the money is too much enough for me to get, there is different cases. Sometimes you cannot help. In fact, this time I have to start work on the Friday. And Mr. Kok tell me to help him out. So I spent 2 days for him. Hello. My pay is 150 per day. Plus the wood, plus the paint. If I estimate wrongly, I have to, I'm in the losing side.
Oh, having a fight? No. Very good friend. I need money. I deliver, I want money. Then he never collect from the customer. He said, don't worry, I will pay you. I said, not because of worry. I said, I don't have money. In Malaysia, consider a poverty is below 3,000 is poverty. But I am a master. If I am making 3,000, people will laugh at you. I am using this. I am holding the machine to make the thing fast. So I am also a craftsman, an art also, using this machine. You see Mr. Kok also, he use a sandpaper. If olden day, they don't allow you to use sandpaper. You use this to sanding, do the sanding. You cannot use sandpaper. So what is the difference between a sandpaper and this machine to do the sanding? It's always the same. It's almost the same. But I'm using this. He say I'm using machine. But if I were using this to carve, oh, he say you are very good. Nowadays, time means money. So everything you need fast. You cannot be slow. You slow, you are eliminated in the society. You cannot say I'm doing art for interest for this. That is bullshit. Every day, you know how many customers come to take the photograph from me? I don't need any tourists. I tell the state government. The only thing they do for us is just print this one for us. So I can print myself this, how much it costs. He thought they are doing the very great things for us. Actually, I'm telling you, are using me. You are using me. Carving, I don't think many people can carve. Sometimes we talk very arrogant. Just like a customer, I give you a price, you want, you take it, you don't want, you just go away. I don't know the amount, how much is satisfaction. Maybe at least 6,000 income and above. I go anywhere, people call me, hi master. So that type of satisfaction, money cannot value. I'm very satisfied with my work. Every day I'm very satisfied.
Okay. 做工咯，规日一路难受，乌亮啊！阿你上今日通车啦，做工规日规日难咯，卖个叫姐姐啦。我做嘛。做来，我是你。 我捌拄着厝厝诶，啊！你这我搞咧厝厝诶咧，是厝厝诶在乎来是厝厝诶，吼，是呢。还有，到底目前呢，爱讲搬伫管理厝诶啥物事呢？就是伊囝婿甲老爷来讲尔，囝婿来讲，走是斗尔，特别拄着我是无啥斗，讲是斗尔。
诶，老爷，刚刚这该这条路建出，该是交大学老爷去料理。乌鸦，乌鸦，乌鸦，我是买样板房，两万两，按公司啊，你看乌鸦。
你本身系搞呢样嘢，可以呢样嘢，唔困难，系只小一样，明白吗？对头家，我呢是正好唔起来，对哦，唔怕佢你唔识俾蚊，要起来又好，你生意咪好咯，对不？诶，咁。
My name is Ong Liang Jing. I'm 91 years old. I've been here for over 50 years now, and I've been selling chemicals most of the time. Soon after the Korean War, I started this shop, but before coming over here, I had already established myself in two other places in town. This is the third premises we occupy. I've been trying to save whatever I can and move over to the new place. Oh yeah, Julia Street previously was, I think, more picturesque. In fact, you have more of these small, tiny shops. They have moved away. Most of them have moved away. All these have to be thrown away. This is forced upon me, I thought, you know. So because by the time I move over there, I would lose most of the customers who come down buying something and chatting away and all that sort of thing. It's more like a meeting place for most of my customers who are very regular and when they have their problems, whether they be chemical or personal or what, they always come down and chat with me for a while, you know. So it's more a meeting place. Like I would prefer to stay, spend my hours here than at home, you know. I have my good company. I have people to, you know, who are interested in things and wanting to know. And I feel very pleased when I can impart some knowledge to them when they have their problems.
What does it mean economically for you to stop working?
It wouldn't make so much of a difference. I feel very lost when at home by yourself because I lost my wife 4 years ago, and that makes me much more difficult to spend time alone in the house. I don't have my children with me. They have their own families, so they have only their own places to live in. So I only have a maid with me at home. So it's quite lonely to be at home. But I think it helps me to be more, make me more a happier man, to be amongst people who at least acknowledge the help I can give them. I don't know the owner, but I think, well, the fact is he has invested some money to buy the property. So what he will want to make some returns on it. So the only way he can do it is make the place, pretty up the place, or make a better appearance of the whole building, and then charge a higher rental. Otherwise, there's no reason why he should invest in a property like this. If I were an investor, I would think of that too. So it can't be helped that we are helpless in that way. We can't actually do anything and they will not compensate you. And it's within their rights, I suppose. If the owner would have maybe one or two houses, and he would more or less handle all the business by himself, he doesn't have to go through a lot. But a person who has a lot of property in Kuala Lumpur and elsewhere, he will have to entrust all this to maybe an estate agent or a lawyer. So actually, he wouldn't care whatever happens to the property as long as there's some revenue being shown at the end of the year.
What do you think if the people on Julia Street get evicted? What will happen to Georgetown then?
Well, that would be a big problem. Yeah. In the end, you only have shops, and I think the whole street will be dead.
And will you keep running your business, or will you get retired? What will you do?
I hope to retire once we move over to the office, you know. I think I earned it now. I should go for a long holiday after this.
My name is Vijayakanth Subramaniam.
என்னோடய நான் கேமரா பிளே வந்து வைஷு.
ஓகே, நீங்கள் எங்கேருந்து வந்திருக்கீங்க?
நான் ஈப்போலேருந்து வந்திருக்கேன்.
ஓகே, ஸோ எத்தனை வருஷமாக ஜார்ஜ் டவுனில்
இருக்கீங்க? ஒரு ஏழு வருஷமாக.
ஏழு வருஷமாக ஜார்ஜ் டவுனில். ஸோ ஸ்கை ஹோட்டலில் எத்தனை
வருஷமாக? ஸ்கை ஹோட்டலில் ஒரு போன வருஷத்துலேருந்து இருக்கேன்.
ஸோ ஒன் இயர், ஒரு வருஷமாக. ஓகே, உங்களோட தொழில் பற்றி உங்களால் சொல்ல முடியுமா?
என்னோடய தொழில் வந்து சம்பாதிக்க வேலை செய்கிறேன்.
ஓகே,
ஹோட்டலில் வேலை செய்கிறேன்.
ஹோட்டலில் வேலை செய்கிறீங்க. ஓகே, ஸோ இப்போ வந்து நான் கேள்விப்பட்டேன், அந்த ஹோட்டல்லேருந்து ஆளுங்களாம் வெளியாக்குறாங்க.
ஆமாம், ஹோட்டலில் வந்து சாப்பிட போகிறாங்க.
அது வந்து உங்களை எப்படி எஃபெக்ட் பண்ணும்?
என்ன மனசு கொஞ்சம் கஷ்டமாக இருக்கும்.
ஓகே,
ஏன்னா ரொம்ப கொஞ்ச நாளாக அங்கே போன வருஷத்துலேருந்து அங்கே இருக்கேன், அதனால் கொஞ்சம் வருத்தம் தான். ஏன் திடீர்னு
ஹோட்டல் மேனேஜ்மெண்ட்டை நீங்கள் கேட்கலையா கேள்வி? ஏன் திடீர்னு எல்லாத்தையும்?
ஏன்னா பிகாஸ் எனக்கு யார் எவ்வளோ எனக்கு தெரியாது.
ஓ ஓகே,
ஏன்னா ஹோட்டல்காரன் தான் வந்து எங்களுக்கு நல்லா பார்த்துக்குவான்.
ஓகே,
மேனேஜ்மெண்ட் ஏதாவது பிரச்சனைனா அவர்கிட்ட சொல்லுவோம், அவர் தான் சார் பார்த்துருங்க.
அவர் பேர்?
அங்கிள் பேர் தெரியாது. ஏன்னா நாங்கள் அங்கிள் அங்கிள் தான் கூப்பிடுவோம்.
எவ்வளோ கஷ்டமாக இருக்குது நீங்கள் வேறு இடம் தேடி போகிறதுக்கு?
ஏன்னா இந்த ஜோஸ்தாவில் எங்களை மாதிரி ஆளுக்கு வந்து இப்போ ஹோட்டலில் ரூம் ஹோட்டலுக்கு கேட்டாலே கொடுக்க மாட்டாங்க, லேஸில் கொடுக்க மாட்டாங்க. ஏன்னா நாங்கள் இந்த வேலை செய்கிறோம் சொல்லிட்டு கொடுக்க மாட்டாங்க. அதனால் இப்போ எந்த ஹோட்டலில் ரூம் கொடுப்பாங்கன்னு தெரியாது. ஏன்னா நாங்கள் தேடுறது வந்து இந்த மாதிரி ஸ்கை ஹோட்டல் மாதிரி. எனக்கு மனசு பிடிச்சமான ஜாமானா, மறக்க முடியாத ஜாமானா, அப்படி ஒரு இதுவும்
இல்லை.
ரொம்ப ரொம்பனா வந்து லோக்கல் தான் வருவாங்க, டூரிஸ்ட் வந்து எப்பயாவது ஒரு டிப் தான். எனக்கு வெளி உலகத்துக்கு என்ன சொல்ல போகிறோம், முக்கால்வாசி எங்கள் மாதிரி ஆளுங்க, எங்கள் மாதிரி ஆளுங்களை கண்டு இது பண்ணாதீங்க, ஒதுக்காதீங்க.
அந்த மாதிரி கசப்பான அனுபவம் இருக்கு அவங்கக்கிட்ட?
கசப்பான அனுபவம்னா பிகாஸ் ஃபேமிலியோட அனுபவம் தான் ரொம்ப.
ஏன்னா
என் ஃபேமிலியில் வந்து இப்போ வரைக்கும் நான் இப்படி ஆயிட்டேன்னு சொல்லி ஏற்றுக்கல,
இன்ன
வரைக்கும் ஏற்றுக்கல யாருமே, என் ஃபாதர் தவிர. எங்களுக்குன்னு ஒரு எங்களை மாதிரி ஆளுக்குன்னு ஒரு ஜாப் கிடச்சிச்சுன்னா இதாக இருக்கும். ஏன்னா எங்கள் மாதிரி ஆளுங்க ரொம்ப பேர் வந்து வசதி இல்லாமல், தங்க இடம் இல்லாமல், வேலை இல்லாமல், கையில் காசு இல்லாமல் தான், வேலை இல்லாத வசதி தான் இந்த வேலை செய்கிறோம். வேலை இருந்தால் இந்த வேலை செய்ய மாட்டோம், பிகாஸ் காசு வேணுமே, அதனால தான் இந்த வேலை செய்கிறோம். வேலை இருந்தால் இந்த வேலை செய்ய மாட்டோம். எங்களை மாதிரி ஆளுக்கு ஒரு வேலை இல்லை, ஒரு இருக்கிறதுக்கு தங்குறதுக்கான ஒரு இடம். ஏன்னா திடீர்னு ஸ்கை ஹோட்டல் விட்டு இப்போ வெளியே வச்சுட்டாங்க, நாங்கள் இப்போ எங்கே போவோம்?
மை நேம் இஸ் லியன் சின்லன். ஸோ மை ஆம் போர்ன் இன் 1953 இஸ் வாட்
How long have you been here in this shop?
In this shop nearly 20 over years.
So how does it feel to move?
I also don't want to move. If they all want to move, what to do? No choice. The letter write to us saying that if 1st of May we didn't ship half the place, so double of the renter. No, temporary no, because he's searching for the place but he didn't have any place yet. So you think now want to find the place also very difficult, because everything, the renter very expensive, cannot stand, no. The owner?
Yeah, do you know the owner for a long time?
And this owner, because this owner not belong to here, in KL. So I never seen him before. It's a lady, one of the ladies. I don't know her. Because he never come here. He asked the club to come and collect money from us every money.
If you were the owner, would you do the same?
I make money, sure, of course lah. Sometimes we adjust lah. You know, so difficult. If too high price, we also cannot stand. No, that's why you see now the market so difficult. Nah, you see very slow. No.
And when you move out here, do you lose money?
Sure, of course, of course.
What do you think is the reason why this has happened?
I don't know now, because the government don't know what to do. They think that heritage, everybody must get out now. This, so how? Hey, if we didn't work here anymore, where got heritage? Where got recycling paper? So see, at least we stand here, some recycling. Now everything, if everybody move out, new people coming in, heritage, no more heritage here. If yesterday morning you come, so happy. You see my granddaughter coming in with the son. So after my granddaughter 4 years old. So he come here, the people come, hey, grandma, can I help you to do thing? What thing? Oh, I help you to sell the thing. Some more the auntie, uncle coming in, he say, auntie, uncle, what you want? She's very cute, 4 years old, but he can talk English and Chinese Mandarin. Yeah, but recycling lot, he seldom go because dusty. Dusty. He has a small children and cannot. Sometimes the germs. But then waste the old paper got germs on my the son, the daughter and then didn't let her to go. Whereas here she can come.
It's quite a problem shifting, you know, just like shifting your own house and all that. But the main problem is to get rid of all the rubbish, you know, things you have accumulated over the years, and you find that it's out there, outdated, you can't find customers anymore. Those were the things you have to part with, and some of them are tainted with memories, and you know, some maybe about 40, 50 years old, but we managed to sell quite a few to the souvenir people. No, they collect them for their shops. And they're quite happy because they couldn't find things like that anymore. So managed to get good prices for them too. I remember those chains we accumulated maybe for 50 or 60 years ago. You know, they were rare finds now. You can't find them anymore, either in Penang or anywhere else. But getting away from the old place, those is like throwing off your old clothes and things like that. Things which you like to have and cannot hold on to. And that's how you would feel. But now, I suppose, we have to face it. And now with this new place, I have to come to have to get used to sitting in an air-conditioned place, a cleaner place perhaps. I think we have to move on, that's all.
Until now, you could look at me and say, hey, Ryan, you've only been showing the negative, the critical sides of the processes right now in Georgetown. And that's a fair criticism. So I do want to mention a few positive sides of what's going on in the death of Georgetown process. Some might call it gentrification. I'll leave it to decide how you want to term it yourself. But there are many positive aspects to the economic changes going on in Georgetown. There are many new cafes. There are many new hotels. Many of the buildings are being altered on the inside. Some would say renovated to a good standard or maybe a bad standard. Instead of using, they're using concrete instead of lime as dictated by the regulations. But there are many products being sold then. There are many new different jobs. The people here are doing work in construction jobs. There is a certain degree of economic activity that's been spurred on by these economic processes. So it's only fair that I point these out. And you know, perhaps all of this is just a cycle. Perhaps it's just a normal cycle in any location, any town, any country where things are built and then over time they disintegrate and then are built up again in a different way. It could be. And I would like to show one more film, highlight a person that I'm very fond of here, Elias. He's a very good man, a great family, a beautiful wife, and a very cute baby. And he started a new business here in Georgetown, and I'd like to show a short film with him. I'm real fond of Elias, and I'd say if Elias is the new face of Georgetown in the future, then I feel that Georgetown is in very good hands.
My name is Elias bin Yunus. I'm a barber. Saya mempunyai barbershop Son and Dad. Di sini kami lebih berkonsepkan old school, vintage, barber chair yang berusia 50-60 tahun lepas. Saya terjumpa satu barber yang famous di YouTube, iaitu Skorgen Barber dari Netherlands. I tengok kat YouTube, I study kat situ, then I rasa macam jiwa I. Yeah, sama dengan jiwa I, jiwa saya. Yang berbeza, barber ada shaving dan juga potongan rambut sahaja. Clipper, machine clipper, adalah berbeza dengan salon yang lain kerana kami lebih kepada clipper sehingga mata yang paling pendek kosong. Itulah beza. Kami juga specialnya kami juga menggunakan razor straight razor di mana salon tak guna. Bisnes semakin maju, semakin meningkat. Saya train dua orang iaitu Fazil yang mempunyai skill fokus yang tinggi, begitu rajin sekali, dan juga cousin saya Faizal. Ya, sama juga. Ya, setiap-tiap hari selepas sembahyang saya hanya berdoa, bersyukur. Saya rasa confident. Saya pergi mana orang dah kenal, memberi lagi semangat, kawan-kawan memberi semangat, terutamanya wife sentiasa menyokong di belakang saya. Masa depan saya ingin menambahkan lagi branch Sun & Dad. Mungkin setiap negeri saya akan adakan satu branch yang baru.
We return to the scene of the crime, to where we started this show from, a Monday morning, the 8th of February, the day right after Chinese New Year. And a man, a person, whose name really isn't that important because it could have been you or me, a woman, a young person, someone old. This man, whose name really isn't important, he got out of bed that morning and he rode his old rusty motorcycle to a site, and he climbed into this backhoe and he put the key into the ignition, and he, with his left finger, it was right over the start button, and he had this beautiful memory, and he remembered his parents, and he heard the laughter of his brothers and sisters, and he remembered how rich he was because he was in this town, in Georgetown, just a beautiful place with so much history and culture and languages and foods and mixing of different people, so unique to the world. And he had this beautiful memory, and then he looked back out across at the building that he was being paid to destroy. He looked at this building and he remembered that he owed the rent that month and that he needed to buy new clothes for his family. He presses the start button and the backhoe roars to life, and these steel jaws, this big arm comes up and slashes down the building and rips it apart, and the timbers come crashing down, and again this arm slashes at the building, and dust comes up and the tiles are ripped down and crushed in two, and it falls, and Georgetown falls, and the building collapses, and the dust rises, and it's no more, it's gone. And slowly the dust settles, and then we realize it's over. It's gone. This is the death of Georgetown.